solvent that actually can suck up the ammonia, merge it with glutamate, and cause glutamine to form. That is low in patients with cirrhosis. Ultimately, all these organs come together and affect the poor brain. And the brain, it affects three specific cell types. One is the microglia, which are the macrophages of the central nervous system. So if there's inflammation in the periphery, there's inflammation in the central nervous system that causes this to actually, the brain to get inflamed. There is also the astrocytes. You know, the astrocytes are the nurturers, the motherships of the neurons. They basically suck up the ammonia, and ammonia doesn't need a receptor, it's freely diffusible. So you don't need to have a receptor, you can't knock it out, it's basically just floats into the brain. These things swell up, because the ammonia, when it's taken up, it forms the glutamine, the exact same thing that the muscles form, except in the brain, this causes this to swell. You know, patients with acute liver failure, who we're going to talk about very briefly, are the people who have this thing play out over days to hours. These people get cerebral edema because those astrocytes swell up so quickly that no compensation is possible. In patients with cirrhosis, because this happens gradually over a very long time, these astrocytes have a way to throw out some things as well, but they remain inflamed, they remain swollen. Also, as part of this inflammation and swelling, the Krebs cycle inside the astrocyte, which supports the neuron, is actually destroyed. So ultimately, the neurons are affected. So the neurons affected becomes the clinical and subclinical part of hepatic encephalopathy. So do not think that this is a reversible condition. It is not reversible. It just depends on how deep you go into it. The patient almost never returns to what they were before the encephalopathy episode. So therefore, we need to prevent further and further encephalopathy episodes, because it's a slow train wreck over time. It's not like a stroke, but it takes a long time. It's like a metabolic stroke. So what are the classifications of HE? As a clinician, and these guidelines were made for clinicians like myself and yourself. So how do you define hepatic encephalopathy? And why was this necessary? This was necessary because hepatic encephalopathy, as we were to talk about, is the gift that keeps on giving nowadays. The varicine bleed is gone. Most of our patients now are infected, old, who have renal disorders, and a lot of comorbid conditions. So it doesn't take long for their brain that has suffered for a very long time to tip over into confusional state. In patients with cirrhosis, that most likely is hepatic encephalopathy, but maybe 20 years ago, those people could have withstood this because they were younger and their brain had not gone through all this trouble. But now at age 70, the compensating factors of the brain do not come across that much. So this kind of repeats itself. So how do you do this? You have type on the left side, which is A, B, and C. A is acute liver failure that we just talked about. Liver is completely normal. Someone takes Tylenol or something else, and then basically the liver has synthetic failure. And they have this sudden form of hepatic encephalopathy that requires a transplant because they'll go to cerebral edema. B is portosystemic bypass. You can never, it's very rare. These are congenital hepatic portosystemic shunts. It's almost impossible to see in practice. C is cirrhosis. C for cirrhosis. Grade is very important because we're going to talk about overt hepatic encephalopathy is something that everyone should be agreeing on. So grade one, which is trivial lack of awareness, sleep-wake alterations, patients feeling anxious, that is not something that you can actually hang your hat on. Whereas grade two, where patient's disoriented and has asterisks, almost everyone who examines that patient will conclude the same thing. Grade three, patients in lethargic or stuporose, basically the patient is sleeping like this, you wake them up, they say some gibberish, they're still disoriented, but you are able to wake them up. And grade four is coma. So two, three, and four, everyone can agree. Grade one and minimal, you need special tests. Or the agreement is so bad that you cannot reliably use it as an endpoint for multi-center trials. So that's why the covert and overt concept came in. Everything that is not overt is covert. That's one big bad. What about the time course? Time course is the most important thing, because often people who do not have inpatient services or people who don't have very diligent hospital medicine experts, they want to get the patient out of the hospital. You don't want to spend two extra minutes trying to find out why is this patient back. And I can give you an example. It's a horrifying example that happened under our watch, and that at the end of this. Your episodic is one episode in 6 months. recurrent, which is really unfortunate in the majority of the patients that we see in tertiary care centers, is more than one episode in 6 months, and persistent is that very rare patient whose encephalopathy never resolved. And of course, a precipitating factor, you need to know what it is. So if you have a patient right now, you kind of want to fill all these four axes in the chart today. If you see a patient with confusion, type C, grade 3 if the patient has stupor, recurrent, and precipitated. This, in one fell swoop, tells you what happened to the patient, what happened to the patient 6 months ago, what caused this HE episode, because we know hepatic encephalopathy is a symptom. It's very rarely the only thing that is going on with that patient. Something else is going on underneath, something else is brewing. And if it is the same precipitating factor that brought the patient into the hospital a month ago, and if you do not treat it now or treat it inadequately, that patient is going to be back. And every time these patients come back, they lose a little bit of their brain, they lose a little bit of their function, they end up falling or something awful happens to them. And we could have prevented at least some of it. The relentless march of this disease will continue, but we want to make sure that we actually figure out what it is. So we had a patient who came in with a UTI. He was on the transplant list, he was number 3. Okay, UTI, no problem. Had an E. coli, sensitive to literally everything. We gave him ciprofloxacin or whatever the usual visual was, and he came back. He had encephalopathy during the UTI. Came back for a second UTI within like 1 month or so. Encephalopathic again, UTI still grew E. coli, now it was resistant to that thing. Okay, we gave him the second line drug. Came in a third time. This time he had fungus, and he had fungus everywhere. That's why, so we obviously had to withhold him from the transplant list, basically try to figure out. He had a large calculus that was blocking his urine from the PUJ. And this was awful, and it was just large enough to block stuff without causing pain. He had no pain. But at this first episode, you can forgive everyone, okay, that first episode. The second episode, we should have actually dug a little bit deeper. And he was a younger guy. I've been with very old guys in the VA, so he didn't have prostate. You would not expect that. He was a relatively younger guy. So that would not have been something that we would have thought of. So that case kind of triggered all of this. Because that guy, thankfully, got transplanted, but it took a lot. It took literally like an act of Congress. You know how many people have to go and bless. The ID people had to come. The surgeons had to come. All the time, this patient had already climbed to the top of the transplant list, but could not get transplanted because no one wants a fungus everywhere after the patient is transplanted. So basically, I would think 2 months of his life were wasted by something that we could have prevented. So things that you do, and so many people came in contact with it, but we need to have an expansive view. We see a different slice of the patient every time we see them, but you want to step back and see what it is, what happened to this patient, so that this respirating factor is not repeated. Okay. So this is a thing that we did across 7 centers in the United States and Canada. We had standardized patient interviews of patients with grade 0, grade 1, grade 2, grade 3, and grade 4, and we sent it to patients, people who were GI fellows, and we sent it to their attendings. We said, what do you grade it as? And as we expected, grade 2 and higher, very high agreement, grade 3, grade 2 and lower, awful agreement. I mean, it was still 60%, but it is certainly not enough for a multi-million dollar company to actually invest in this as an endpoint. Can you imagine just by chance, if this happening, and a drug that is ineffective being approved, or a drug that is effective, more importantly, not being approved for a patient like this. So you have to have very important science, especially for multi-center studies and in patients that you have who are doing this. So for the residents and the fellows who are in the room, you know the patient, this is a waxing and waning disorder. You will have certain kind of issues with those patients. That's why you need standardized videos. So you can have a patient who is completely alert in the morning, but when your attending finally comes to ground, they can accuse you of being completely ridiculous because the patient is now. So you really have to keep that into account when you talk about things like this. So this is a very difficult disorder to quantify, which is why the Westhaven criteria were the only criteria we had, and now we don't have those. The FDA will not accept that. So what is the burden of cirrhosis in HE? The discharges for HE are increasing. Every time you look at it, whichever database you look, we have more patients for HE. And this is a gift, as I said, which keeps on giving. Look at the number one, HE, readmission in 90 days. Look at the number two, renal and metabolic. Look at the number four, okay, three is others, infection. All of these are precipitating factors for HE. It just marked who else, who was, who thought that this was the first episode and the 80 was the most important thing. Obviously, no one just has 80. There are many other things together. But if 80 was not, all of these other things were. So this complex of renal metabolic disorder, frailty, hepatic encephalopathy, and infections are really part and parcel of cirrhosis practice nowadays. These are patients who are older and fatter. They're not going to get any younger. They're just going to get more and more encephalopathic, and we need to take care of them. And how can we take care of them? When they're not taken care of by the transplant system. The question is, we have to make them feel better, and we want to make their caregivers also feel better, because it's a disorder of the entire family. It's not a disorder of the patient. The entire family suffers when someone has hepatic encephalopathy. If you take objective measures of hepatic encephalopathy, which very few people do in practice, because they're often to do, critical frequency, even the stroop, it's very difficult to do with every single patient. Okay, you need a quiet room, you need equipment, etc., etc. If you added that to the biological MELD score, it was equivalent of 7 points. So that is the amount of encephalopathy that is not captured by the MELD score. And why did we have to change the MELD score as opposed to the CTP score? Because we want the best for our patients, so we used to lie. 2002, there was an epidemic of grade 3 and 4 encephalopathy, which would increase your CTP score. After MELD came in, within 1 month, all those patients lost their grade 3 and 4 encephalopathy status. Did that happen naturally? Absolutely not. Did we bother? We went back and said that it's not worth marking that because no one gets any extra points? Most likely, yes. So we have to have something more objective for encephalopathy. Are those ammonia levels? No, thank God, someone's. So I'm just giving you a teaser for what's going to come, full-on assault on ammonia. Okay, so covert HE. That is the first part. Remember, the overt HE part is when patients are confused. We now figure out HE has four axes. The four axes are for the overt section. Remember, the definition said there's a subclinical part. This is the subclinical part. This is the part that the patient tells you, I can't do my work very well. This is the part where the patient's wife or husband tells you that he or she has been ignoring me extra, you know, or something else. Something else has changed in their behavior, which is very subtle. The patient is completely alert. The patient is not confused. The patient does not have asprixis. And if you've been seeing that patient for a very long time, you know something is wrong. I can give you another example. I feel like a very old uncle here telling war stories. There's a patient who, when he's okay, he's an awful person. He's an awful human being. He's gruff. He's awful. He doesn't like to deal with anyone. He's antisocial. He comes in, does the barest minimum with his poor wife chugging along. When he becomes nice, then you have to be very, very worried about him. Now the whole house staff knows about that thing. When he starts becoming cranky, they're like, yes, our treatment is working. So that's how you know. But I know this patient for 10 years. So now I know when he starts becoming nice and actually wishing me good morning, I said, something's wrong with you. So that's how you know. But that is not enough for someone else who had no idea what this patient is about to actually figure out what's going on. So it is associated with a poor quality of life. Our patients with cirrhosis, as I told you, are living longer because they're older. Because the NASH epidemic hits people in their 60s and 70s rather than the 40s and 50s, which was the Hep C epidemic. It affects quality of life. So when you discharge someone to the hospital, or when you diagnose someone with cirrhosis, you just don't have a liver disease. You have a disease that affects the brain, a disease that affects the muscles, a disease that affects everything. So it actually makes them feel awful. So covert hepatic encephalopathy makes people feel awful. And how do we know that? Because when you treat people, it makes them feel better in randomized studies, blinded studies. Okay. It is also associated independently with death, hospitalization, and overt HE. Now, these are patients that we took from our clinic who were completely alert and oriented, never had encephalopathy before. These are the people that you look in clinic, you wouldn't even bat twice. You wouldn't even know they have cirrhosis. These are the people. We did cognitive testing on them, and we divided them into covert HE yes and covert HE no. And this is the first visit to HE. So this is the probability of being free, estimated probably of no HE on your y-axis. And you can see the blue are the people who remained free, who didn't have covert HE, and in the bottom are months, 60 months, or we follow them up to 5 years. Covert HE patients in the red had less probability of getting an overt HE episode, basically their first overt HE episode. What about all hospitalization? Again, What about death? Again. So covert HE impairment, the brain, is not just a marker for overt HE, it's a marker of what is going to happen to them as a whole. And this is, you can substitute minimal or covert HE here with sarcopenia, with quality of life. Basically, this is the way where the MERIT score fails our patients. But this is one way of saying that this is a marker of doing things. And if you correct it, if the patient feels better, why don't we look at it? So it helps, it worsens the progression of HE, worsens the quality of life, it impairs driving, I'm not going to talk about that a whole lot, it impairs overall survival and socioeconomic status, and it can be tested for. Now, how do we test for it? There are many, many tests, but I'm not going to go over the tests that are absolutely impossible to do. I do it very, very infrequently, the testing. Regularly, we do testing using these things. The apps are EncephalApp, the quality of life using sickness impact profile, and animal naming tests, and the inhibitory control test. The inhibitory control test takes a long time to do, and it's for very high-functioning people. The animal naming test is the easiest of all of them. Because it's the easiest, it's also the easiest to pass. So this is, in 1 minute, you have to write down 15 different animals. Okay, can't be frog, another frog, and yet another frog, 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 you know, etc., etc. And you can be as generic as you want, that's not a problem, or you can be as specific as you want. This is taken from dementia. So 15 and higher, in an Italian study, showed that these people would have covert variants at all. But this is only useful in the people like that guy who becomes, you know, from mean, he becomes happy. That's the guy where something has already been set into motion, but it hasn't hit that disorientation mark yet. The apps and the quality of life can be positive in very, very high functioning patients. Because you really, that's the challenge. In the high functioning patients right now, you want to find out which of these high functioning patients are really not as high functioning. They just appear high functioning. They're cognitively impaired. And if these are the four questions, I do not maintain balance. Remember, these patients have sarcopenia and problems like that. I act irritable or impatient with myself. I'm not doing any of my usual recreation or activities, and I'm eating much less than usual. If four of these questions are all checked yes, there's an 80% likelihood that this patient is going to have covert hepatic encephalopathy. So if you have nothing else to ask the patient, ask them these questions. Okay. This is a sickness impact profile. This will give you the more important thing for these questions, these real world things, is the negative predictive value. Positive predictive value is like home, home, because you need to then confirm it. But it's important to realize that if these tests are negative, it's almost impossible for these patients to meaningfully have covert encephalopathy. So it's good as an exclusion for most of these patients. Okay? What about the stroke? This has been done now in many, many countries, in China, in India, every other place. And this is available for free download. I did not invent this. I made this app. The stroke is done by the actual person called stroke, which means sugar. So stroop waffles, that's actually sugar waffles in Dutch. But that's the guy who's in Britain, actually, not the Dutch guy. But sometimes actually in Britain. So who should be tested? You really shouldn't be testing everyone. You really should be testing people who are more likely to suffer if they have covert HE, and more importantly, have nothing else going on that would explain these impairments. Because none of these tests are specific for covert HE. They are just specific for cognitive impairment. So if someone has alcohol on board, if someone is actively taking cocaine, if someone has schizophrenia, if someone has bipolar disorder, someone has heavy duty narcotics, this is going to be abnormal. And that can all happen in the background of cirrhosis. But does it mean that this person has covert HE? No, it means this patient has cognitive impairment. Now you can go and backtrack why this patient had a cognitive impairment. It would take many neurological examinations, but it tells you this patient is cognitively impaired. So you want to actually, for the biggest bang for your buck, focus on people in whom, realistically, this would be the only part reason for cognitive impairment, and who would feel bad or be affected the most if this was positive. So current drivers, currently employed people, those who have specific cognitive complaints, who come to you, I'm feeling tired, I'm not sleeping as well, blah, 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 and those who have poor quality of life, if you do a formal assessment of these people. These are the people, most likely, if you find covert HE and there's nothing else going wrong with them, and if you treat it, they might feel better. So, no current overt HE, no psychoactive drugs. Now that is impossible to find in patients with cirrhosis, right? Especially in the VA. So what psychoactive drugs are okay? Chronic opioids, provided it's been chronic for a very long time, are okay. Antidepressants are okay because it's uncontrolled depression that causes it. Controlled depression actually fixes a lot of these cognitive impairments. So if there are steady doses of SSRIs, that's not a problem. No uncontrolled neuropsychological disorders, and you're going to give a patient something that will make it very apparent to them that they're doing something badly. Okay. So you have to counsel them that we are doing this to help you because we have a treatment at the end of it. You don't want to be, you know, say, leave this raw gaping wound in their psyche about this test that they cannot complete, and then don't do anything to offer them a therapy after that. You obviously have to have a quiet environment. You can't do it in the middle of a clinic where the phones are ringing, things go back and forth, etc. And this is like chemistry exam. If you've downloaded the Stroop test or something like that, it has a script. That script needs to be followed word by word because those are the ingredients you put to this exam. You can't ad-lib, you can't do two things or three things at the same time. That same thing has to be followed. There's a lot of thought that has gone into all these tests because this is the equivalent of you putting 0.2 ml of this reagent and 0.5 ml of that reagent. If you change any of that, things go completely bizarre. So, to me, we do this in a separate room before the patient sees us in clinic. It is done by a medical assistant who has a lot of time and it's not very expensive. So that's their only job. Typically, what we end up doing is the person who ends up doing the fibroscan in our patients also end up doing this because that is a quiet private room and that is like 5 to 10 minutes more of the patient's time. We do it as standard of care. So we have the results with us when the patient sees us. So this has to be done properly or not at all. And for the hepatologist in this room, just the equivalent is this is as important as doing an ultrasound for HCC screening or an endoscopy for varices. We don't expect to do that the patient is in the clinic, right? This is something that could have implications for a very long time for the patient because you can treat it, you can follow it. So you want to it deserves a little more time and attention to be done appropriately. So you do not want to give it to someone who's actively drunk. You don't want to give it to people who just think have other reasons to do it. So what is the Stroop? So the task is to correctly and rapidly press the color corresponding to the color of symbols presented. So this is the off state. This is the easy state, okay? This is the hashtags or whatever you call it. Touch the current color, blue, is the right time. Response time is in there. So you can see if someone has problems with, and it's red, green, and blue, right? So if someone is colorblind, it's torture to give this to them, okay? Please do not. Ask them, are you colorblind or not? If they don't, there's many apps that will tell you that whether they're colorblind, because 20% of men are colorblind, red, green, colorblind. Okay. So what about this one? This is the on state, okay? The ask is still the same. Your mind is screaming green, but the actual answer is blue, because the word green is written in blue. You still have to do the same thing that was asked. So the on state requires a little more extra from your brain. So that is the stuff that tests something that is higher mental level beyond what is just a psychomotor speed, red, green, and blue. So you do this, and after a little while, it spits out a number. The multi-center validation study, this is basically, by the way, one of the largest apps, one of the most tested apps in the world, not just in encephalopathy, not just in liver disease, in the world, because now it has Chinese people in there. So when the Chinese come, you already automatically have thousands of people. Now, they have two publications out of the CVH that were thankfully not horrible for this app. But it's okay. It worked. It worked in other places as well. So, and it could predict who develops encephalopathy in the next few months. Not only in one center, this is in 4 centers. And we created norms for this. And now we've created norms. And how do you actually figure out who has MHE or not? You go to this website. You need to know the patient's age, the gender, education level, and the off-time plus on-time. It's a number that is spit out at the end of this app. You put it in, and it will check out, and it'll tell you what the expected number should be for someone of this age, this gender, this education level, and it tells you, according to these norms, whether this patient is MHE or not. So the norms are already fed in. We know what 300 controls would do, and therefore what the non-controls would do as well.
Does it change how much sleep you have?
Yes. It does, but that sleep change could be because of liver disease and self-love.
Right, what if the dog kept up all night? I mean,
but then don't do this app. No, you have to do all of those things. You have to make sure that everything is absolutely okay for this patient. You have to use your clinical judgment. Of course, if the patient is falling asleep right now, they will not be able to follow anything. The patient is clinically encephalopathic. Just that. It's going to be nothing. So those are the patients you want to actually make sure. So we talked about stool. Now let's talk about stool or the microbial change. Okay, the simplistic way of figuring out why the microbial change is important is look at clinical practice. Okay. Hepatic encephalopathy is the finest example of the gut-brain axis you can ever find in this world. Okay. All the depression, autism, schizophrenia takes months, years, decades to develop. Encephalopathic patient, comatose, large bowel movements, completely away. You cannot get it better than this. Now we need to find out what is it, and do we need to evacuate the entire bowels multiple times, much to everyone's distress, and continue doing that for the rest of the patient's natural life until they get a transplant, or we can actually do a surgical strike, or multiple surgical strikes, or a complete replacement. Those are the things that we are worried about and we want to do. So microbial change in cirrhosis, and this is beyond encephalopathy, can predict change in outcomes in outpatients and inpatients. Of course, the altered gut-brain liver axis is the problem. When you do the MRI, you actually can figure out. Remember I told you there were two cells that were abnormal? There's the astrocytes and microglia. Microglia can affect the neurons. So there's a way in specialized MRI you can actually find out what is the astrocyte version, which is the ammonia-related, and what is the inflammation version, which is much more related to the, you know, the neurons and the microglia. So we were able to figure that out in the patient's stool, the patient's colonic mucosa, that they were directly linked, correlated with cognitive function. And these were all the good bugs, the ruminococcaceae and lactamaspirace. These are the bugs that produce short-chain fatty acids. And we know short-chain fatty acids are good for the intestinal epithelium, intestinal barrier, which is absolutely abnormal in patients with cirrhosis. What also is important is these bugs produce secondary bile acids, and they indicate everything is okay in your gut. So these bugs were associated with brain function. So if these bugs were higher, you had less ammonia-related change. But what was very stunning to us was there was an entirely different group of bugs that were affecting the inflammatory part. And those bugs were Porphyromonades. Are you familiar with that? Porphyromonas gingivalis. And we're going to be talking a little bit more about it. For anyone who has examined a patient with cirrhosis, as they're driving the scope, you'll see there's hardly any teeth, or it's like a war zone. There's no teeth, or there's a war zone inside their mouth. And there's multiple reasons why that happens. And part of that, Porphyromonas gingivalis, which causes periodontitis, which is by far the most common infectious disease, infectious complication we have in the world right now, until the teeth are gone, and that's the only cure for it. That can cause brain dysfunction. That has been linked not just in hepatic encephalopathy, but in Alzheimer's disease and many other brain dysfunctions. So you need to treat your teeth. And the teeth are not just a wayfaring system when you go and enter your scope in these patients. They're actually important. I'm going to show you some evidence a little bit later. So the microbiota, the saliva, reflects the stool. And it can actually predict whether these patients get hospitalized. The microbiota in the stool in our patients can predict that. And the microbiota in these patients can also predict who has encephalopathy or not. So we are right now applying for a patent of actually a rapid system in which you get the patient's stool, you send it to a laboratory, and they tell you whether they have a cutoff. So you don't even need to test even the stool. Send a spit or to the lab, and they'll give a rapid thing back. Do you need to test this patient or not? If those things are present, you may send them for testing. If not, etc., etc. So again, negative predictive value is important here, because you can't possibly test the thousands of patients with cirrhosis. It's impossible. So what about inpatients? You know, outpatients are easy. They're nice and quiet. Nothing happens to them. Inpatients are messy. They have antibiotics. They have whatever brought them into the hospital in the first place. They have pain medicines. They don't want to give consent. Even in this horrible environment, the microbiota were able to predict on the left, top left side. There are two screens. I'm sorry, I can't put a... Does this work? Can you see? Nah, maybe not. Top, look at the orange bar. It's acute encephalopathy, and they compared it to healthy people compensated in decompensated cirrhosis. And there were certain bacteria that could predict who is going to have a poor outcome. Okay, this was a replication of our study that was done before, in which, and this is very scary. Okay, these are patients who came to the hospital. We took their microbiota on admission. Okay, so who gives microbiota on admission? These are people who are awake, alert, not in the ICU, not pooping their guts out because of this. We had to get consent for these patients. Okay, so these are not so sick patients, basically my thing. Microbiota on admission in our single center study could predict who lives or dies in 30 days. And what is important is, in those 30 days, we were not just sitting twiddling our thumbs, we were actually treating the patient with whatever things we had at our disposal. But still, the microbial makeup and on admission kind of decided where this patient was going to go. This was replicated by the Chinese people who, instead of doing it in admission, did it every day. So this is a principal component analysis, because the microbiota analysis is so sparse and non-parametric, they do it this way so that you can actually take a 30,000 feet view. Here, anything in the red are people who cluster, who have microbiota that are similar to each other. Anything in the blue, which are the triangles on the top right side, are separate from the red. It doesn't tell you which those microbes are, but it tells you they're different. So everyone in the red died. Everyone in the blue survived. So the microbiota and admission in single center studies will tell you who lives or dies. So we said, oh, okay, single center study. In the bottom left are people from a multi-center study, 9 centers across the United States and Canada, same thing. On admission, if you do a microbiota analysis, you can predict who's going to develop organ failures, acute or chronic liver failure, and die. That's very depressing, because that means we did nothing to their microbiota, and something else could have predicted. So that tells you it pays to know what the microbiota things are. Right now, translation it into practice is a little bit difficult in inpatients, but in outpatients, it's coming. It's coming. It's actually much easier. But what this is meant to scare you, that we should not ignore our outpatients, because once they're an inpatient, it's too late. Things have already, the horse has left the barn. Because whatever you do, that microbial makeup they came in with is going to then decide what's going on. That doesn't mean you ignore them completely if they have a bad microbiota, you know, please treat them. But it just tells you that you may treat them, need to treat them harder, longer, or actually not discharge them as quickly. And this is what I just told you, microbiota can be used to exclude this. And I'm just going to skip this slide. It's basically what I've been talking about who has HE and who doesn't. So let's come to now a more comfortable thing that we all have a little solid bearing on, which is overtaking, which is an acute episode and prevention of recurrence. Those are the two challenges. Someone comes in actively confused, and now they're better, they're about to go home, you want to predict recurrence and prevent it. So what are the treatment goals? In acute, you want to treat the precipitating factors, improve the mental status, and evaluate for liver transplant. In outpatients, you want to improve the daily functioning, prevent the recurrent episodes, and again, evaluate for liver transplant. And this is very important, because that's the only lasting cure for hepatic encephalopathy is a transplant. You really want to do that. So even though it is not really brought up by the MELD score, it's a marker of everything else going bad in these patients. And you know, transplant workups can sometimes take months for these patients. So if someone has overt encephalopathy, time to think. And if you're not affiliated with the transplant center, send the patient to a transplant center, go manage. So what if someone comes in confused? Is it really overtaking? Is the patient's airway safe? What precipitated it? Has the patient become alert? And if not, why not? So all these four things need to happen together. To destabilize the airway, you want to make sure that the patient is in a monitored setting, especially if they have grade 3 or 4. Coma, no questions asked, they should be in any ICU, but grade 3 is where things become a little hairy. That's when the patient is lethargic and stupor. Patients with hepatic encephalopathy get a lot of aspiration pneumonia. That should not happen, you know, under our watch, because you want to put them where the nurses can actually see them, the critical care, the physicians and specialists can also see them. You want to evaluate them for alternatives, like drug screen, psychiatric disorders, etc. If the patient is the 6th episode and they present exactly like what they were, then you maybe not need to waste your time doing the CAT scan, etc. again and again. Of course, identify precipitating factors and commence empirical therapy. So the rule of thumb really here is, treat all of these things at the same time. If the patient has hepatic encephalopathy, you should really be starting all of these things at the same time. It's very rare that a patient with cirrhosis ends up getting something else than encephalopathy when they're confused. 95% of the time, when the patient with cirrhosis comes in, whom you know has cirrhosis, comes in the ultimate status. It's going to be some form of encephalopathy. The challenge really comes in, what is the precipitating factor? But you'll be surprised in those 5%. So it pays in those things to actually figure these things out. If there are new focal deficits, that's not encephalopathy. If there are excitatory motor activities, especially seizures, that is very rare to find in encephalopathy. It's very common in acute liver failure. But it is impossible or almost very rare to see in patients who have cirrhosis and hepatic encephalopathy. Current or recent alcohol use, it could be withdrawal. Current, recent, illegal, or even legal sedating drugs like opioids, as well as sleep medicines that these patients are often prescribed, or they were taking when they were non-cirrhotic, and now it has gradually, their toxic to therapeutic ratio has dwindled. And again, other situations, please, like you said, hasn't slept last night, things like that. Those are the things that you want to keep a lookout for. Because just because someone has cirrhosis doesn't mean that they're immune to everything else that happens. What is the differential diagnosis? Diabetes, number one, because patients can have precipitating factors because of diabetes, but 60 to 70% of our patients have diabetes. They had a little bit more, lesser before, but even Hep C was coexisting with diabetes a lot. NASH, of course, is almost synonymous with diabetes. And alcohol also goes with NASH with that. So of course, alcohol is the number two. And drugs and electrolyte disorders and intracranial bleeding, especially in the frail alcoholic person who may have hit his head 6 weeks ago and now comes in with a little confusion. In those people, it's important. Sleep aids and pain medicines. If you have time, please read this nice review, Lewis et al., Alimentary Pharmacology and Therapeutics in 2013. It goes over each and every drug that is available and their half-life in patients with cirrhosis, and it's shocking. Look at the diazepam and zolpidem, often half-life is increased twofold. So you can be drunk on zolpidem, literally. The next day, you'll basically be driving on as if you're drunk. Again, one of my Wisconsin stories, they used to DUIs in Wisconsin. Cheese and beer doesn't get more DUI like that. One of my patients was yellow as a canary, poor thing. Was started on zolpidem by her primary MD, much against my advice, and she took 10 milligrams because 5 was not working. And then she said, okay, maybe I'm not falling asleep, maybe take another one. And then she was driving to an appointment with me. And was meandering and was found driving in Indian style on the left side of the road instead of the right side of the road, and was picked up. Thankfully, she was going very slowly. She didn't hit anyone except whatever, the police car. And she had the presence of mind to have my pager number. I called this medical college of Wisconsin and talked to Dr. Bitt. She mispronounced my name, but they found it anyway. They called me, and this happened. She was on zolpidem. She was strict talking to by me and by the police officers and everyone. But this can lead to real consequences for your patients. You can't just, and if you see it, I hope you've not started it. But if you see something, do something, okay? Don't say something, you have to do something. You can withdraw them. Opioids, I would not touch with a barge pole, because most of these patients have been on opioids for a while. And people can seriously go into opioid withdrawal, which is worse than encephalopathy in these patients. So the opioids, you need to hook up with the primary care physician, with a pain physician or someone who has experience along with you to manage those opioids. But things such as zolpidem, Benadryl, these are sedating medications, you really need to either remove it yourself or consult with someone who has more experience than you to do.
You know what I see a lot is neurontin.
Yeah.
Especially, the number you gave earlier is pretty striking, 60-70% diabetics. And
yeah.
I would say probably half of them get gamma-7.
Yeah.
And then what happens is the VA, they just leave mine.
Yeah.
And so I imagine that's probably...
Then it contributes, but it's not as sedating as you would think compared to the other stuff our poor veterans are on. Especially the PTSD and all the other layers of complexity that they present. But Neurontin is kind of, I would say, the least of their sedating drugs. But in a person who is not on anything else, that may have an issue. But then you have to look at, is it neuropathy versus, it works for patients with neuropathy. But I think everything has to be done after talking to the patient. Of course, I had no problem convincing this lady that zolpidem was a bad thing for her. But it required a near arrest for me to do that, because I told her, do not take. She went behind my back and got her primary care physician to order it to her. She knew it was bad, but how bad she got to know 3 days later. So blood ammonia. If there are two questions that I'm asked, one of them, and first and second are all blood ammonia. Please don't do it. It will not help you. The only way it will help you if a patient is completely confused and you do a blood ammonia and it is normal, and it's stone cold normal. Ammonia is false positive most of the time because everything makes it go higher. Leave it long enough, it goes higher. Put a tourniquet, which 100% of us do. Do not believe anyone who doesn't do tourniquet, ammonia without tourniquet. It is drawn with other blood ammonia. They don't just, your phlebotomist doesn't just take the tourniquet off and say, oh, now I must do ammonia. Then that's never happens. So everything that is false positive with ammonia is high. High ammonia. The flip side is also true. Patients are often condemned to a lifetime of lactose to treat their ammonia level. Can you imagine having gas in 7 bowel movements every day for the rest of your life to treat an ammonia level where he was completely alert and oriented? And by the time they come to you in a tertiary care center, they don't even remember if they were disoriented in the past or not, because they're disoriented now. I mean, you have no idea, and you don't believe them. It's like the PPIs. No one knows why they were started, but they just happened to be on, and they just continued on for posterity. So it's very important for us to realize that blood ammonia cause more confusion to the person who orders them than to the person who actually is getting them. It's from Adrian Rubin, he did that. It's very nice. So what are the targets? Obviously, you would expect the brain would be the biggest target, right? But that is the organ which has been targeted the least by all the pharmaceutical agencies, because it has it's very difficult to actually reach the brain in quantities that you want, because of the absorption area that changes the cerebral blood flow, changes in cirrhosis. So the majority of things are either the gut or ammonia that is around that. So you obviously have rifaximin, lactulose, FMT. You have things that attack the muscle. Ornithine phenylacetate, branched chain amino acids, and L-ornithine, L-aspartate. Out of this, none of them are either available or under investigation right now. Branched chain amino acids are LOLA or LOLA are present in other countries, but they're not approved in the United States. There are certain other things that basically go and suck up the ammonia from the system. Right now, what we're dealt with is lactulose and rifaximin.
Is it ever used for mass in
them? No, never. It causes seizures. And so that's why it kind of was banned, really was banned. So it didn't work. It worked wonderfully in animals, you know, like most things do, but it didn't work in humans. What about lactulose versus peg prep in an acute HA episode? In this nice study, somewhat underpowered, they found that peg was not only similar, but it actually trended to be better than lactulose. So if someone has ileus, those are the people I tend to use peg on. Okay. Because lactulose causes ileus, peg doesn't cause it that much. And if someone cannot afford rifaximin, I'm looking at the Salix representative. Okay, those are the people, and can't tolerate lactulose, those are the people I put on peg. This is unlabeled, unapproved use for the powers that be. Okay. What about lactulose plus rifaximin in an acute setting? Only one study done from India has not been replicated. But you know, our thing is to throw the kitchen sink at people, so we do it. So someone comes in confused, they divide, randomize them into lactulose plus rifaximin. Lo and behold, the ones in group A were lactulose plus rifaximin. The survival is on your y-axis, the days are in your x-axis. They had a survival benefit, which has not been replicated since. So, but we do it regardless. Again, unapproved, unlabeled, etc., etc. So the patients get better, provided you do all of that. In majority of cases, patients should get better. We're talking about the rare persistent case a little bit later, but majority of the time, the patients are now ready for discharge. What are the questions? How can we prevent this from happening again? Is the patient able to perform all activities of daily living or instrumental activities of daily living? Are the caregivers able to handle the patient? Is the patient a transplant candidate? If the answer to the point 2 and 3 are I don't know, or I didn't have time to talk to the caregiver, or I don't know who the caregiver is, then you have not done a good job. Okay? Whether you be a hospitalist, whether you be a nurse practitioner, whether you be a fellow, a resident, or medical staff, or whoever it is, in a patient with hepatic encephalopathy, if you have not assessed the functional status of the patient on discharge, and by functional status, I'm going to also talk about nutritional status on discharge, and have not counseled the family on how to take these medicines, or how to, what to look out for these patients, when to call us, then it is not appropriate to just give them rifaximin and say, my work is done. You will see that patient that rebounds so fast and come back to your team if you're house staff or hospitalist or inpatient service. It'll come back really badly, and it'll come back with something that you'll make you reconsider what you did the first time. But the thing is, the middle two things require a frame shift from us being medicine providers to medical providers. Okay. We don't want to be just the people who give medicines and give them in a vacuum, because it's important. Because what's the first line therapy? Is lactulose. Lactulose fluorosis placebo after their first episode of HE had a much lower risk of recurrence. But there's a problem with that. Okay. And you do not tell them to the patient. If you don't tell this to patients, they will not take it. Now, how many of you discuss your regular bowel movement frequencies with your spouse, husband, or your children every day? Do you? Please be that one abnormal one. So, no, right? And now you're suddenly expecting this person who has had their first episode of HE to tell their family member how many bowel movements they had yesterday. And to increase the bowel movements if they remember how many they had, but it's all because to prevent confusion. And now if you're confused, how would you remember how many bowel movements you had? And if you have not counseled the family member what to look out for and what to ask for, they will not know to ask the patient. And now the patient will come to you in coma, where they could have come to you in grade zero, when the patient was constipated for the whole day, and you didn't counsel the family member that this is bad, the patient should not be constipated. You call us if that happens, or you give the patient more lactulose. This has become a disease that is a loss of power. It's a loss of control. And many people find it very hard to give up control. So it requires a lot of thought and counseling, because people who have been charged, these are middle-aged people or older people who live life on their own terms for their entire life. And now you're telling them that even their bowel movements will be dictated by someone else who'll give them lactulose. It's a big deal. It's a big deal. So almost always these people come back for recurrence. And what do? At that point, you're licensed to give them rifaximin, because rifaximin, in addition to lactulose, is better than placebo alone. Placebo plus lactulose, 91% of these patients were on rifaximin. What's more important, not only did it stop the recurrence of encephalopathy, it reduced the hospitalizations. And the amount that every hospitalization, regardless of whether it results in ICU or not, costs, means this is cost effective for years and years and years. So even if it prevents one hospitalization, by the way, the NNT was 9. Beta blockers 34. I mean, things that we take for granted are like quadruples higher than what the insurance companies fight with that tooth and nail to give us these medicines that have. This is the only part of hepatic encephalopathy that has grade A evidence. Grade A, everything else is conjecture and people futzing around and talking, oh, maybe this or that. This is the one of the few places where we have grade A randomized controlled double-blind placebo-controlled trials. And what's important is there's a nice study that is that hopefully gets published very soon, that rifaximin would also work to prevent encephalopathy after TIPS. This is a multi-center study done in France in patients with TIPS before the elective TIPS were started on rifaximin a week before, so it was in their blood, gut, I guess. Gut doesn't really get absorbed in the blood, versus placebo. And they found that you can see the Kaplan-Meier diverges, right? So the possibility of recurrence is lower in the top graph, which is the rifaximin, rather than the bottom, which is placebo. So this is very important to realize that this actually, if you do a large enough study, you'll find sample, something one way or the other. And this is where the rub comes in. You know, we can go after the next shiny thing, or the fecal transplant, but if we don't consolidate the stuff that we already know, then you're starting from a flawed platform. If 60% of people did not receive prophylactic therapy on discharge from the hospital, then that's a game that we have not won yet. That is a battle that is still ongoing, because it is not enough to hand over a prescription or have a nurse do their regular droning on and on and on and on about this, where a cataclysm has affected this family. One of their, most likely, it is their breadwinner, is now not a breadwinner, cannot drive, cannot do everything. So the person in charge now becomes someone who is not used to being in charge and now has to make all the decisions. And they handed over a prescription and said, see you. Maybe they're given clinic with a gastroenterologist or hepatologist if they're lucky to have one around them. Or maybe they're just sent back to the primary care physician if they're lucky. Or maybe they have not even set up an appointment. It's these deeply unsexy, awful little things that add up to make these patients' lives miserable. And when their lives are miserable, their families' lives are miserable. And when their lives are miserable, our lives are miserable. Because now they, if we see them in a much worse state than they were when we left them before, for things that are utterly preventable. So nowadays, we mandate that these people, we have a clinic by nurse practitioners in which 3 slots are always open per week. We mandate them. You cannot fill it in. Those are for hospital discharges. And those are hepatology nurse practitioners who are critical to our business. Critical, absolutely critical. And they basically receive, so what we do, our hospitalists or whoever it is, directly get in touch with them. So when someone is discharged, they say, this is a person coming in, and we get that person. So that person at least has a safety net if things somehow do not get counseled to the patient. So how can we make this better? Improving the setup. That's very hard to do, but this is what we end up doing. It worked for our setup. You may have to find something different in your setup. You can actually force people into completing a checklist. In this nice study done by Elliot Tapper, they randomized patients from an outside liver place, and in one, they used a paper checklist, and the third one, the more draconian one, they could not discharge the patient until all those things had been met in the electronic record. The discharge summary would not populate without it. And one of them was starting on lactulose and rifaximin. And the readmission rate went down dramatically only in the ones where we were forced, our hands were tied. So the system has to change. If the system doesn't change, please do not rely on the kindness of strangers. We all have very busy lives. We all need to get a move on to our next patient, next whatever. So anything that we don't have to do, we won't do it unless we think that's an important thing to do. You can work the patient's body. And that's why, remember, sarcopenia is important. You must talk to them about things that are not medicine. And that's why we usually, as an inpatient, have a physical therapy consult for these patients. Most often the time, the patient already has a walker or whatever, so it's not really important. But many of these times, the patient are at fall risk and can be prevented by a little bit of exercise. What about nutrition? Our nutritionists are the linchpin. This is another very boring part, but is the highest yield that you can possibly get. Daily energy intake, 35 to 40 kilocalories of dry body weight. And important, do not restrict protein. 1.2 to 1.5 grams per kg per day. And a late night snack. These are the 3 important things you can realize. And keep your nutritionist very close. Because this study done by our house staff, we did a retrospective analysis of how many nutrition concepts we had before and in patients. Then we educated the house staff. We educated the nutritional people. In the VA, the nutritionists do not need a formal consult to see anyone with cirrhosis. But they do have a list of what the wards are and who has cirrhosis. So after we trained them, it jumped from 40 to 75%. And it actually resulted in a readmission reduction in these patients. How much did it charge the VA? $0. Those people were already paid to do this. We just reminded them that it is important, and you are part of our team. Every time we used to do rounds, we used to check with them. What was it, XYZ? So they do not feel like they're in a little cubby hole somewhere, working in a vacuum, tapping their ensure orders. You know, you want to make sure that they're part of your team. Because without them, you can throw as much rifaximin, lactulose on these patients, they're not going to get better. They will not have enough muscle mass to actually make those things better for these patients. So this is the cheapest recommendation, one of the most effective ones that you can actually do for their patient. What about mindfulness, working the mind? There's a lot of uncertainty, not only in the patient, but in the caregivers. In this small trial that we did, only 4 weeks of mindfulness improved people's depression, improved people's sleep, improved their overall quality of life, and the caregivers felt less burdened. This is easy. There are many apps. You can just throw an app. This is one thing it's acceptable to throw at them. Because, you know, they can say, they can do the app, they can't do the app. But at least you're thinking of them beyond a lot of these usual medicine part that you think about. What about persistent HE? Remember, this is one group of rare patients who does not get better. These people may have a shunt. splenorenal shunt. If you embolize it, especially the MEL score is low and they have one shunt, the patients can get better. And this could be very important. So we talked about things that have now the entire spectrum of HE. But there's still people who keep on coming. They're on laterals, they're on rifaximin, they're doing everything they can. The disease can progress, of course. The worst case scenario is someone who has a relatively low MEL score, 17, 18, 20. Does not have one shunt, has 20 shunts. So you can't embolize all of them because the liver will die, really. And they keep on coming back. This is a patient who is not going to be get any relief from our current transplant system, and you can't just see them. What's going to happen to them? So you can clean their teeth. Their brain function got better once you clean their teeth. Again, something no one will fault you for doing. This is something people should be doing. Most people hate dentists, me included. Especially, I actually hate the dental hygienists who make you feel this small when you look at your gums. Then I think they do a crash course in how to make people feel awful about themselves. So you didn't clean. But when you actually randomized, you took patients with cirrhosis with and without encephalopathy. Some of them got the treatment, some of them didn't, and healthy controls. You reduce their MEL score, reduce the WBC count, improve their salivary microbiota and their stool microbiota. And in the people who did not get this, things remained stable and their endotoxin actually went up. This is something that is kind of standard of care for these patients. This is something that you should be doing. This is something that you should be paying more attention to.